get it on. Got to get it on. Happy to welcome back to the podcast Teresa Strasser and Bald Brian. It's good to see you guys. Been a couple of days.
Yeah, good to see you guys.
It's so good to be here. I miss us.
Teresa, everyone loves these shows. It's easy and it just feels like a nice warm slipper. Nicely broken in. So, Teresa, you're in month number what of your pregnancy?
I'm in month number 5.
Mm-hmm.
But my boobs are in month number 9.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah.
Nice. And, Brian, how's your health?
Oh, I'm hanging in. I'm doing good, man. I'm halfway done with treatment. I started at week number 4 out of 6 today, and I feel good. I mean, my brain tumor symptoms are getting kind of worse, but talked to the doctor about it. He said that's totally normal, that he totally expected to get the radiation, and it's going to make it seem worse at times, but eventually it should get better.
So what happens is the radiation sort of activates the tumor or the symptoms a little bit?
Yes, exactly. It swells your brain, makes it kind of like feel worse, and the symptoms can get worse. But, you know, the way I think about it, the way I guess it makes sense to me is imagine if you were a tumor, and if you're getting radiated every day, you're gonna thrash about and scramble too.
Yeah,
you know?
I would swell.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was like junior high for me.
That's right.
You felt like a tumor.
Yeah, I did. I felt like a cancer that's trying to be carved out of my house.
No, we have something in common.
So if you see Brian, I would say his movements are sort of deliberate, kind of have that old man at the supermarket look.
I feel drunk all the time, you know what I mean? Like, I can compare it to how you feel when you feel drunk. You're like, oh, steady, you know, got to steady yourself and hold on to things. I got a little dizziness, but... It's the doctor said it's normal, and if they say it's normal, then I'm...
Yeah, it sounds positive because they're radiating, they're pulverizing the bad stuff,
yeah,
and that's making it swell a little.
And you know, like, it psychologically, it almost feels good to know that things are working and things are happening, you know?
Yes,
it's like it feels
movement.
Like progress being made.
Yes, and how about driving?
Drive very deliberately and cautiously. It's like being a first-time driver. It's like you really got to like pay attention to the road. I don't do a lot of music and stuff. It's really... I've got to let Christy, my fiance, do most of the driving. She's happy to do it. But times like this, you know, it feels good. It feels good to be normal. It feels good to get behind the wheel and drive, you know, deliberately and cautiously. And
So you're able... So now you have another few weeks left. You're about halfway into the cycle.
Yeah, I got 3 weeks left.
3 weeks left on a 6-week cycle, and then you take how long off?
I get about 4 weeks off from everything, and the radiation is done after 6 weeks. Apparently, you can only do radiation once. It's a one-time deal. So the radiation is done after these 6 weeks, and then I get a 4-week break, at which point I go back on the chemotherapy, and that's only 5 days out of 30. So they're short cycles for mm-hmm. chemotherapy.
How many cycles do you do?
I think it's an indefinite thing. Adam was talking earlier on an earlier broadcast about Dr. Bruce's sister, Donna, if I can use her first name. She had a very similar tumor to what I have, and actually I think she still has it. You know, they were able to get under control with the radiation and the chemo. She did the exact same thing that I did, and this was like 8 years ago. And I talked to her at your...
Did she do the chemo and the radiation?
I believe so.
Oh, okay.
I believe so.
I didn't know she did that.
She talked to my parents and my fiancé for a long time because I think they had a lot of questions for her, how to go and how's it going. And mm-hmm. she's, you know, as normal as can be, and that's the goal for me 8 years down
great.
The road.
Yeah.
Yeah. These tumors... somehow get started very early on, but then sometimes the symptoms don't present themselves until later on in life.
Yeah.
In her case, it was probably not till she was 45.
And if I could thank Dr. Bruce, he already thanked him, but he was the guy that called me right away and, you know, was like, checked in on me. He's like, hey, my sister has what you have, and if you want to talk to her, that'd be great. And I finally got in
Drew did have his publicist call you. And send over a generic fruit basket, did he not?
He had muffin basket, and he might have Twittered.
Yeah, I got an edible arrangement from Drew. It wasn't signed Drew, it had printed Drew.
Right, but it's fruit that looks like flowers.
Yeah. No, so I love that.
Yeah, Dr. Bruce is a great guy who seems to have sort of boundless energy for other people's junk, just not so much his own, and who has weird kids who were over at my house the other day. Let me just change the subject here to, look, what's wrong with kids today? I know I just sound like Officer Klamsky from the 50s, Kransky or whatever, Pops Corolla.
What's
but
wrong
I mean,
with kids?
First off, this is all comes off the heels of Jimmy's son got pulled over, I believe, on the way back from our My wife said, you know, Jimmy's son got pulled over on the way back from the Malibu Kager on the freeway. And I said, oh, Jesus, was he drunk? Was he weaving? Was he speeding? No, he was going 40 on the 101. And the cop, and I launched into, what the fuck is wrong? Like, Donnie, when you were 16 or 17, you were doing e-brakes, Brodies, 360s, on the lawn doing donuts, right?
It was a different time period.
I know, but I'm just saying. So I go from that to, you know, when I'm talking to Dr. Bruce's kids and I'm like, we're going to order pizza for him. I'm like, well, you know, his son is, I don't know, 10, 11. His daughter's like 14. Well, what do you like on your pizza? I don't know. Well, what do you like? I don't know. Well, what's your favorite topping? It doesn't matter. Well, okay, I know it doesn't matter, but just go ahead and shout one out. I mean, well, you must have a favorite. Not really.
I like the despair lover's pizza.
Yeah. I like tears. I like the salty brine of tears.
That's right.
Do you have orphan tears?
I don't like crazy bread, but I don't mind sad bread.
What? I want half orphan tears and half the broken backs of widows who've been forced to work after their husbands died in mines. Like, so here's, and then every argument I get to my wife goes like this. Well, you got to have one you like. Adam, leave them alone. I'm not attacking. I'm just saying, is it pineapple and
like sausage?
Sausage.
What?
And
pepperoni?
What do you like?
Quit badgering them with things they like.
I know. And then it becomes this, yeah, stop badgering them. Leave them alone. When I was 14, if someone said, you know, first off, what do you want on your pizza? I'd be like, pizza? We're getting pizza? Can we get two pizzas? Yes. What's going on? I'll have everything. Put everything on there. Like, put everything but anchovies on there. Like, put everything on the pizza. Yeah. And then if someone had, like, nailed me down, I would have given them 15 things I like on a pizza and then asked if we could get a Coke. Like, that's the other thing, too. Like, I can't tell you how many kids I've said, like, they've come into my house and they're the kids of parents who come over, and you go, "Ah, you want an orange juice or a Coke or Sprite or 7-Up? No, thanks." What?
Who turns down a free soft drink?
When you were fucking 12, if someone said, "Do you want a root beer?" Would it be like, "No, thanks, old man"? Like, really?
You know what was the height of fine dining? Like when we went out and we could order a soft drink with our dinner.
Yes.
That felt like the most luxurious thing. Like, to me, to this day, I still love drinking out of a straw because I associate that with, you know, a paid for drink.
Totally.
And was there a scenario that you could remember that, like if I was 12 and I just did some sort of Dad's Presents the root beer consumption competition from Coney Island, done on Memorial Day, and I just drank 70 liters of root beer and then yacked it all up through my nose. If I showed up at one of my friend's house and they offered me a root beer, I still would have taken it and said, I'll drink it later.
Right, yeah.
There was no scenario under which I would have gone nah. And I offer kids like Cokes, root beers, you want some cookies, you want some candy.
Don't you also think that the kids' taste is different? Like, there's not regular Coke that you've grown up with. There's so many varieties of drinks. Maybe they're just into a different.
I think kids are just douchebags now. I really think they're just assholes.
Do you offer them any of the other things that you yourself would have liked as a teenager? Like, look, here's a Playboy. Would you like to see, I don't know who this woman is, but she's nude in the middle. Take a look. She's a Swedish supermodel.
I don't, like, I can't tell you all the kids, like, I had this happen with Jimmy's kid. I've had it happen with Bruce's kid where I've like, hey, why don't you grab the football and we'll go toss it around. I don't think so. What? I know it's a different time. I know everyone has video games and everyone has real things they can do and computers and the internet and all that kind of shit. But the root beer or the Coke? No, thanks.
Plus, when you were younger, you had that one, maybe, like, father or family you went over, and they're like, would you like it? And you're like, yes, whatever you got, I'll take. Because you only got good stuff. You got a root beer, Coke, something. It's not going to be some crappy soda, some juice.
I'm trying to think of the number of things, especially food items, I've turned down. Like, when I was 12, if I came into someone's house and they went, hey, do you want tuberculosis? I would have been like, yeah, awesome.
So. Is that crunchy or is that something that's more
is that
sweet?
It's
kind of mucusy. I'll take it.
That sounds good. Do you have any consumption?
I know. It's just, what is the casual, I don't care what's on my pizza. First off, no general excitement over pizza.
Right.
I would have shouted the word pizza at least 12 times. Pizza, pizza, we're doing pizza. Who's it? And then there would have been questions like, who's getting the pizza and why aren't they gone? And the other, I'll take it a step further. Not only the pizza stuff, not only the Coke stuff, but I have a warehouse here and there's like mini bikes and dune buggies and shit like that. And my friend's kids walk through here all the time, barely give it a second look. If I was 10 or 13 or 9 and I walked through my warehouse, I'd be like, what's going on with that mini bike? Whose mini bike is that? What's that? Does it run? Does it run? Can we ride it? Can we ride it? Whose mini bike? Whose go-kart is that? Who's going to go on that go-kart? You know what I need? I need a root beer, I need some pizza, and I need a go-kart right now. What's going on with that go-kart? Does it run? Whose is that? Like, first question would always be, whose is that? How does it work?
Can I use
and
it?
When can we get it out to the fucking parking lot? Not, uh-huh. I mean, kids walk through my warehouse, they just step right over the go-kart and, like, keep walking. Donnie, am I making this up?
You're absolutely right.
What the fuck is wrong with everybody?
I don't know. Like, in our day, it was like a panic, like there was a fire, an emergency, if you saw something interesting that you wanted to kind of take.
If I walked into some kid's garage and he had Honda XR75, like, leaning against the bench or mini bike or go-kart, I would have been like, huh? What is this? What is... Whose is this? Where does it go? Where can we do this?
It would have been emanating light.
Yeah, we're like, ah. The garage door would open, shaft of light. I'd be holding my hand up to shield it from my face. There's a mini bike. Nah.
You actually might have thought that you were dead.
Yes, I've died and gone to mini bike heaven.
Because I can't be alive because I'm the like latchkey, grape nuts, single mom kid.
Right. I couldn't. Now, what is going on? It's not just, I mean, everyone goes, people have money now, or people don't give a...
And you want to scream at the kids, you're like, please, please react to my recaptured youth.
Right.
And they're like, fair.
I'm offering you pizza. I need you to react.
What is going on? Well, you know, the females I give a pass to, but the males stepping right over the mini bikes, walking right past the go-karts, right past the soda, and right past the pizza. Nothing. And an age range of 9-year-old or even 7-year-old to like 15-year-old, not an interest. No, by the way, the whole reason I know how to ride a unicycle is because my dad went to his girlfriend's house in, you know, 1977, and there was a unicycle sitting in the kid's room. And I was like, what is this? What is this?
I play
like,
this.
It's a unicycle. The kid wasn't home and no one was around. And I'm sure my dad just wanted to, you know, make out on the sofa or something. So I said, I will take this unicycle. I will go out into the sidewalk. I'll hang on to the side of a tree or a car fender and I'll teach myself to ride it for the next 2 hours. And I was like, yeah, go ahead.
To this day, even though I'm like, you know, pushing 40 up a hill, or I should say 30, I see a Malibu Dream House or like those pink Barbie Corvettes, something in me wants to touch it. And play
mm-hmm.
with it.
Mm-hmm.
It's still magical.
Is stuff too, like, plentiful? Because it's not really about money. I mean, shit is cheap now, and toys are cheap, and I also feel like there's no season for buying toys. It's like there was duck hunting season, and you could only hunt ducks during these months, and now it's open season. Right. And, like, my wife was saying to me a month ago, we got to get the kids a swing set. They want a swing set. They want to play on the swings. They want to get a big swing with a jungle gym and a slide. And I said, well, their birthday's coming up. Oh, well, we'll get it for them now. I said, why don't we wait a month and we'll give it to them for their birthday? But they want the swing set now. I know, but there's this thing that you get gifts on your birthday and you get gifts for Christmas.
You build
and you get
up
gifts
anticipation.
For... Right.
And then it has meaning.
It's called foreplay.
Right.
Well, it really is.
Hey, Teresa, when did you get your ears pierced? Or do you have your ears pierced?
Yeah, I got my ears pierced when I was probably 9 or 10.
Because I'm going to wait with my daughters. I'm going to wait till they're somewhere around 10 before they get their
I
ears
couldn't
pierced.
Wait. I could not wait to get my ears pierced. But I think
wasn't
I had
it a bigger
my...
build, though?
There know? Was a build. I think I had to keep my room clean for a month every
Why?
Day.
Why? Your daughters want to get their ears pierced?
No. know, they have no realization of it yet. But it's like, you know, some, I think a lot of kids today, the parents are just giving them the ear piercing.
Well, those are Mexicans. You know. They get their ear pierced when they're four.
No, I think there's a lot of girls.
Unless you're going to be pregnant at 12, you better get your ears pierced. You better get that out of the way.
Nani, do your girls, Fiona and Charlie, play with dolls?
Yes, they love dolls. They're girls. They're girly girls.
Yeah, my son, you can threaten him by, like, you come at him with something pink,
right, soft.
And it's a, and it's like coming at Count Dracula with a cross. Like, no, no, no. And my daughters ran around like a whore with the makeup spread out like a drunken whore. She's applying her own makeup.
Oh, good.
And by the way, these gifts, like, hey, and this is, you know, we're talking about Dr. Bruce. There's a couple of horrible, horrible gifts. My sister got them gifts that you've heard me complain about before, which is the plastic food. It's little miniature hot dogs.
Oh, yeah,
it's miniature watermelons, all this stuff. First off, obviously you can choke on this shit.
Right.
Secondly, it's all filled with melamine and shit from China. I mean, I'm sure it's, first off, it's just plastic. I mean, do you really want your two-year-old just gnawing on plastic? God knows what kind of weird resins and shit is in there. That's just the plastic. Right. Forget about the orange dye number 15 that's on the hot dog that comes from China out of the tainted batch of paint over there. But then second, and then thirdly, what message are you sending? Here's a hot dog. These are what hot dogs taste like. Weird, plasticky taste. Like, so this sort of game or this gift of, we're going to get fake food to fuck with the kids who are going to put it in their mouth,
yeah,
and possibly choke on it.
Right.
And at least, best case scenario, they'll get a little brain damage from taking on some of the...
Brian is sitting right here.
He doesn't have damage.
Not yet. I'm going to Vegas this weekend for a bachelor party, so God willing, I'll come back with some brain damage.
Oh my God.
It's a great place to be stumbly.
My fantasy is that you'll be stumbly.
Right.
And then some bartender will be a real asshole and say, sir, you gotta go.
Even though it served.
And then you'll say, you know what? I know I seem drunk, but I have a brain tumor.
I'm gonna get to the craps table and knock over a stack of chips. Totally sober, by the way. I'd be like, all assembly, and I'm like, sir, you've been overserved. Please step away from the craps table.
Can you drink at all, by the way?
Yeah, totally.
Oh, good.
I mean, the doctor, it sounds silly. The doctor's like, you know, best not to get wasted if you can. And I said, okay. But the last thing I want to do right now is get wasted because I feel drunk and I walk around.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right, yeah.
So this will be a fun experiment.
So the second worst gift you can get besides the fake food is the fake little makeup kit, like the Dolly Parton makeup kit. Because my daughter's smearing the shit all over her face, and not only all over her face, all over the counter, all over the floor, all over the drapes. The shit is getting all over the fucking place. And what do you, so you get to teach your kid how to be a trollop. This is awesome.
And three-year-olds don't have really tasteful ideas about their makeup.
No.
You know?
Bigger's like, better.
Yeah, in my I think probably kindergarten class picture, so maybe I'm five. I have a full face of makeup.
Really?
And I looked at it later. I asked my mom, like, why did you let me go to school like that? And she said, well, it was picture day, and you were really enthusiastic, and you had to get into the makeup. But I have, like, what? I mean, I look like a hooer. I have, like, red cheeks and blue eyes, and I think I tried to feather my hair a little bit.
Yes, you don't. There's not a lot of subtlety at that age.
I wasn't doing shading.
With anything. And. Yeah. So she's got that smeared all over her face, and he's playing with the trucks, and he has no interest in that shit. And as a matter of fact, we'll start screaming if she comes near him with that stuff. I mean, you have no idea how much this shit is cemented in, how early and how often. And I just can't, and I know I've screamed about this many, many times, but I just can't believe growing up in the 70s that we bought, at least a small retarded segment of our culture bought this idea that this was foisted on us by the man. When they come out of the hatch and the girls make a beeline for the Barbie dolls and the boys make a beeline for the Tonka trucks, and that's 99% of it. Once in a while, you get one of the Arquettes who's a little bit confused about which one to fuck with. But for the most part, you have two daughters, so you don't know. If you had a son, he'd be nuts for the trains, nuts for the Tonka trucks, and by the way, nuts for solitude. Just solitude. Leave me the fuck alone. I got my trains. Clear out of here. I don't want to be bothered. Whereas the daughter just follows you around, tugging, and by the way,
leaving makeup smears on your pants.
And playing you. just, you know, she's got a dolly. She's got her own dolly. Her dolly's sleeping. She's telling me to be quiet. The dolly's sleeping. She wants the dolly. She doesn't want this blankie. She wants that blankie. She doesn't want the mermaid outfit. She wants the princess outfit. Put the princess outfit on me. Get the. And the second you leave something behind, go get it. Go get it. You know, she goes to the car. I want my sippy cup. Here's your sippy cup. No, not the Jasmine sippy cup, the Little Mermaid sippy cup. Oh, just use this sippy cup. See, he doesn't have those rules because he just cares that he only wants water. She doesn't want water because there's water in the Jasmine sippy cup.
Right.
She wants to manipulate you and get you to go back into the house and go get the other sippy cup for her.
Yeah, but she melts your heart.
She does. And as I've said on the podcast before, the way she, you know, it's nap time. The difference between men and women, it's nap time. And Olga, the nanny, says, Sonny, give Daddy a kiss. Good night. And he won't come in. Hi, Daddy. And he gives me a big kiss, and he goes off to the room. And then Natalia, give Daddy a kiss. No. Daddy, give Daddy a kiss before nap time. No. Kiss Daddy before. No. No. Not going to do it until Olga says, well, then that's my daddy, and I'm going to give him a kiss, and you don't kiss him because that. And then she looks at Olga and gives her a look like, fuck off, bitch. And she walks right over and gives me a kiss and then gives Olga another look. And then Olga goes, don't kiss him again. Oh, yeah? Gives him another look? Like, you love it, don't you, bitch? Gives me a second kiss and then goes to bed. That's how she gets the kiss. But this, she's not even three yet in starting the manipulation.
My baby just started kicking just sitting here talking about
really?
It. And my little boy's like, don't worry. I'm not going to pull that shit on you.
That will be me.
Guys, you know, here's what I would say about guys. Self-contained. Just can go off down to the workshop, into the garage, off to the warehouse, and just spend 5 hours there with nothing but the talk radio going.
Low maintenance.
Low maintenance.
Yeah. Yeah. It doesn't require a lot of upkeep.
I feel like I just swallowed a cell phone and somebody's calling me and it's on vibrate.
Really?
That's how it feels.
Baby's yeah, it's kicking great. Away. Really?
Yeah, he like, yeah, that or like popcorn.
Is it, are you in good enough condition to try some news?
Well, I mean, the bar is pretty low for me, yeah. I think, at this point. So I think, yeah.
We were, you know, with the reunion and all, we thought we'd try some news. We'd try some Skype calls as well. But Teresa brought in some news. That's what I love about her. Nice prep.
I'm all ready. Oh, no music.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
No, wow. No music.
Can you hum something, Brian?
I heard how it goes.
I had a fantasy yesterday that I think I emailed Brian that we could have Isaac Hayes back.
Oh,
because I really feel like with everything going on with Brian's health,
right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, doctors know things, but not like Isaac Hayes knows things.
Yes.
Isaac is clairvoyant to an extent.
Yeah, I want to ask him, like, is Brian going to be okay, and are these symptoms going to diminish? And I want to ask him about my baby. Like,
he really had a magic eight ball-like quality to him. He really, he looked like one.
Yeah. He did.
But and he also had the same cadence.
Yeah, and now he's like an angel looking down. Like, I want to know, you know, is my baby going to be healthy, and is he going to love me? And
it's good.
Yeah, it's good, you know? Yeah. I miss it, but maybe we can work on that.
I'll work on that.
Can you get into heaven with a chainmail vest?
At least purgatory.
Like, I don't know how St. Peter works, but if I saw Isaac Hayes, I'd need to see some ID. Like, whoa.
Listen, I don't think you know exactly who he is.
We don't need your kind of trouble. Oh, Grammy Award winning. Mr. Hayes, sorry.
But wait, Scientologist.
Sorry, Isaac.
Yeah. All right, in brief, before I launch
it. It's got to be a weird move, like St. Peter's over there at the gate, and he's got his hand on that lever with the hatch. And he sees the huge black bald guy in the chainmail vest come walking
Moses.
Up. And he sees the black Moses. And so you see his hands start to move toward the. And then he's like,
Mr. Hayes.
Yes, Mr. Hayes. Oh, Graham. I see you have Graham. You see his hand slide off the lever. Oh, Scientologist. Ooh, you see the hand start to slide back toward the hatch again.
Okay, so in brief, before I launch into some news, I have to thank your listeners. Your podcast listeners are amazing. First of all, how many of them showed up to Shakespeare at your house?
That was awesome. There were a lot of people there, and they were also nice.
Yeah, they were all really, really nice. And then last time I was here, we talked about names for a little baby no name. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people logged on to exploitingmybaby.com,
mm-hmm.
and I got 223 name suggestions from your fans. So I just wanted to tell you that the most popular of those, by the way, 16 people pro James. They don't think James will be Jim. A lot of people pro Shane. You guys like Shane.
They don't think James will be Jim.
Yeah, they say that that's the older generation of James, that those guys are Jim. But now James can retain their Jamesness.
You have to work at it.
They have to work at it. But your listeners like Andrew, Elijah, and Ryan. And then second, they like Jake, Ian, Declan, and William.
Declan, pretentious.
Pretentious.
William is fine, but that turns into a Bill. Ryan, I don't know. I just feel, we don't need another Ryan.
No. I like Jake.
Jake's cute.
Jake's solid, but you know what? Jake and Max had a sort of renaissance a few years ago, and they got kind of fucked out a little.
Jake may be the most, Jacob is the most popular boy's
name. Oh, yeah. Jake works well with your last name.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. And Andrew's great. Nicknamed Drew. Who doesn't love that?
He'll be an Andy.
Drew is an Andrew, isn't it?
Yeah, Drew's an Andrew, I think.
Yeah, I've never really done that math. And by the way, you should only get one because Andrew has Andy, right? Andrew?
Yeah.
You've taken your name and whacked into that many pieces?
Yeah. I know.
Adam's got nothing.
I know.
You didn't have one.
You got two names coming and going, with Andrew. Yeah.
And secondly, okay, so I've gotten a lot of traffic lately on my site, not only from your listeners, thank you, but from, I ended up on a fetish website.
Oh, really?
Breastexpansion.net. Nice. But I'll take it. Like, link is a link.
Sure.
But it's very bizarre.
What's that website again?
Breast Expansion.
I don't know. It's like Teresa. Oh, yeah.
I guess there are people who are very fascinated with women whose breasts grow.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Which pregnancy will cause. Mm-hmm. In my case, perhaps more than others.
Yeah.
And perhaps an outlier in that regard, because I'm up a couple cup sizes.
Nice. Mm-hmm.
About to head into a D.
I was going to say, how's that work? Did you have to buy new bras?
Yeah. In fact, I bought a C cup, and then I was just sitting there. I promise I'll get to news. I was just sitting there.
This is news.
Having coffee. Yeah. I was having coffee with a friend at an outdoor cafe, and I was just sitting stock still, and then maybe I exhaled, and maybe I pitched like 4 degrees forward. My front clasp bra just popped open. It just burst open.
Wow.
Hold on, slow down.
In public. But I mean, I'm used to being an A cup. I didn't even wear a bra. I didn't have to wear a bra. And now I've got to get my tits back in.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because I'm out in public and I don't, and I got to wrangle them. And anyway, I wrote about the experience of just all of a sudden having boobs, and somebody linked to it on this fetish site, and now I'm getting a lot of traffic.
It'd be cool if there was some sort of condition that you could go through as a dude for 9 months where your cock grew.
Well, I was thinking,
I put on 4 inches of length and 2.5 inches of girth. Yeah.
Don't worry, it'll go away.
Yeah, I had to switch from the midways to briefs. I had to step up a size.
That's a lunch of the friend.
It just burst out of my pants.
And I started laughing, and my cock shot out of my fly.
tore my underwear wide
open. And the thing is, your cock gets a little swollen. It gets a little chafed against your pants. But I think more analogous would be just suddenly having giant balls. Because you think, big balls. Metaphorically, everyone wants big balls. But you don't really.
No, but here's the thing. Women don't lust after big balls. Otherwise, I would hang them out of my shorts.
That's another fetish.
You know, women going, man, that guy's got, he's ugly and he's dumb.
But have you seen his balls?
He's on disability, but he has a mammoth scrotum sack. And I'm so enamored with it.
Why is she with him?
Two reasons.
It's either the nose candy or the sack candy. Yeah. Oh, I just want to go myself and bury myself in his huge balls. Now, I've never even heard a woman bring up balls.
I'd imagine they'd be totally neutral to them.
I think they're very adorable. I don't mind balls.
I know, but I mean, but it's never gonna. You're not gonna close a deal. It's like, here's the thing. I've said this about balls many times.
This sounded great.
No, I'm serious. You could take George Clooney and Brad Pitt's balls.
Done.
And Johnny Depp's balls and put them through a hole in a piece of plywood. And probably be one of the worst picture opportunities at Coney Island.
Sure.
But you just shove their sack through that and just let it dangle through this thing. And then you could take George Wendt's balls.
Right.
And you could take
John Goodman's
balls, and
Eli Wallach.
Yeah, Eli Wallach, one of the least
John
attractive.
Ratzenberger. Let's just go with the whole class of years. Woody Harrelson.
Yeah, Eli Wallach, one of the least attractive men on the planet. But no, the guy who had the deformed skull who was on The Hills Have Eyes.
Oh, yes. Oh,
yeah. That actor. I mean, you could take the guy from The Hills Have Eyes and you could take his balls and hang them through the plywood and put them right next to Brad Pitt's balls and George Clooney's balls, and you wouldn't know whose balls were attached to who. Right. Now, that's rare. You wouldn't do that with lips or teeth or eyes or nose on a beautiful woman versus an unattractive woman, you know?
Sure, there are extremes. I mean, Wilford Brimley's balls might have a few grays.
Yeah, you could. Oh, I could pick his balls out of a lineup in a fucking heartbeat.
Can and have.
Yes, done and done again. But I'm just saying, women, you know, they're not attracted to balls. It's nice that you don't mind them, but you're not attracted to them.
No, yeah, I don't. We don't really care. They're incidental, unless there's something really egregious.
Right. I was thinking, like, guys have weird fetishes with feet or hands or whatever, like, you know, like, oh, the woman's got really sexy wrists, and you're like, oh, all right, I don't see it, but you do. I don't think there's a single woman out there who would ever even consider, like, oh, I bet he's got great balls.
No, I never heard that.
No, and don't even need to see him. Don't want to touch him. Like, won't have anything to do with them. So it's sad that they're as big as they are and placed where they are. You know, they should be in the small of your back.
They're prominent. Yeah.
And they should be smaller because they don't really serve any function, you know? I mean, the breasts, you know, they serve something. You know, there's...
Oh, balls, that's where you cook up the baby.
No, I know
mine now don't serve any function.
They do something. I'm just saying they're basically in the way and they're not attractive. The breasts have a function, but it also tracks men and feeds babies.
Oh,
you know?
Sure. It convinces men that are looking at you that you're fertile.
Right.
And thus they'll want to talk to you.
Right. All right. Do you have news,
I do.
By the way?
Okay. Now, if any of these stories seem boring, feel free to tell me. Do not be shy. Okay. Let's start with this story. Speaking of Dr. Drew. Now, this story is a couple days old, but I had to run it by you. Mary Carey... this from AVN. Mary Carey has returned to porn after a 3-year hiatus, her exposure on VH1 Celebrity Rehab and Sober House in her new movie, which is called Celebrity Pornhab with Dr. Screw.
I think Jimmy sent me an email that says, you know you've arrived.
Pornhab!
Which is sort of kind of true.
Yeah.
Mary Carey, the last season I saw her on that show, had put on a couple extra pounds. And the thing about porn stars is they're not really known for their discipline. You know, they're not like fighters who are going to go to camp and do altitude training and shed those pounds. And she's got big jugs.
Yeah.
So I look forward to this, which always bumps me, but it's always one of those tells. Like, you know, the kind of we've talked about before, like the guy with the sweaty palm before he shakes your hand will do the slight hand wipe on the thigh before he gets to.
Right.
The chick with the big jugs who also has the gut will wear the bustier that's pulled down but conveniently placed around the gut.
Right.
Right.
So whenever you see the chicks who have the guts in the porn, they're always the ones that have that weird sort of... Yeah, it's the corset bustier thing that gets pulled down to expose
the boobs,
which is good. And then underneath it, it's fine. But it's just that couple of rolls in the center. Expect her to be donning one of those. Yeah. That's all I'm saying. And it's sort of sad, isn't it not?
It is. She, in this particular porn...
Oh, God, I can't wait. Oh, will Drew play himself?
Interesting you should ask that, Dr. Screw.
I mean, Dr. Screw.
Play a version of himself called Dr. Screw.
Mary Carey will not be playing a patient. She's going to play Nurse Carey.
Sure.
Sort of like Drew's real-life assistant, Shelley.
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Screw...
It's a real homage.
It'll be an homage. Dr. Screw, I don't know if you know this actor, will be played by Mike Horner.
Yes.
She's also going to be doing, Mary Carey, going to be doing a girl-girl scene with Lexi Tyler, who plays Tanya Clitain. Mary Carey says about doing porn, and she talks about how Dr. Drew said, you know, she should really get away from porn if she wanted to stay clean. And she says, when you're in that situation, it's easy to get into that anti-porn state of mind. But eventually, you have to go back to the real world and make a living. She says, I love Dr. Drew, and I think he's a great guy, but I think it's hypocritical of him. He has adult film stars on Loveline all the time. He does a radio show about sex.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And she says, porn didn't make me drink or use drugs. I always liked to drink since I was in college. I don't think there's any correlation between that and addiction to drugs and alcohol. Now, you may be wondering, what does Dr. Screw?
I think there is a correlation, though, which is that when your self-esteem starts to erode and then you just start to go, oh, fuck it. Like, it's right. That sort of like, I already had 4 cookies. Like, I'm right. On my diet.
Yes.
I always think of it in terms of diet. Like, you go, I'm on a diet. I'm not going to eat any of those donuts. And then you go, all right, you know what? I'm going to have half of a donut. And at a certain point, you just eat the donut. And now it's like you're off the diet. And you're kind of, you're feeling kind of shame. And you go, oh, fuck it. And you eat 6 donuts. Right. I do think porn does this with the drugs and the alcohol and that kind of stuff, which is when you have trouble looking yourself in the mirror, especially because you have pink eye, you tend to, it makes it a lot easier to drown that out with booze and drugs. But it's also this sort of like, I don't know exactly how to explain this, but if you're a smoker and you don't want to smoke, start working out a lot. Because when you're you don't want to smoke a cigarette before you work out, because it's like, I'm going to go play hoop. And then you don't feel like smoking a cigarette after you work out, because you're sweaty and you just worked out, and you go like, I can't do it now. It's when you crack a beer that you feel like smoking that cigarette. And I feel like porn is sort of that beer versus working out.
Yeah, her self-esteem is already way off its diet, so it might as well do a porn
right.
And take his Xanax and drink.
Right.
Well, Dr. Drew sent out a Twitter saying, for those of you wondering about my feelings about Mary Ellen Cook's choice to mock, res ipsa loquitur makes me very sad. Now, that is, of course, a legal term, meaning the thing speaks for itself, res ipsa loquitur. It's used in tort law, like if a barrel falls on my head, were you negligent in putting the barrel up there? Well, it fell on my head, so it speaks for itself.
Right. So Drew Twittered Latin.
Yeah, he Twittered Latin tort law.
This is a fairly rare thing. I get a lot of Latin tweets.
Him and Kutcher both do all their twittering in Latin.
I'm
if so facto, Drew.
Exactly. That's an ad hominem attack on Ashton Kutcher. Yes, often confused. Okay, so here's another story from the Spokesman Review. The Guinness Book of World Records is being sued by the most litigious man in the world for naming him the most litigious man in the world.
Sweet irony.
Wow.
Sweet irony. The lawsuit Zeus, also known as Johnny Tsunami, filed a lawsuit this week in federal court seeking an injunction to stop the Guinness Book of World Records from naming him as the person who has filed the most lawsuits in the history of mankind. This guy, Jonathan Lee Riches, a.k.a. Irving Picard, filed his latest legal fight
like
this week.
He's like 10 James Bond villains in one.
He really is. Filed his latest legal fight this week in the Richland office of the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of Washington, although he is currently incarcerated in Lexington, Kentucky.
Good.
I believe he is up to some wire fraud. Now,
Johnny Lee Richards, better remember as a member of the Stray Cats or as a Bond villain?
Yeah.
Great name.
Or the captain of the Enterprise.
That's right.
Johnny Picard.
I was just saying to somebody, when all these people that have like the multiple suits, I don't care if their 15th one is legitimate or not. I don't care if they're burned over 90% of their body. I still want it thrown out based on the suits that they filed before that. I really hate these guys in our society clogging up the system, and they're responsible for all the rules we have and all the fucking safety this and childproof that. It's all these guys, and I'm glad he's in prison and fuck him. Thank you.
He did a little wire fraud. That's why he's behind bars. But he still sues people from in the joint.
Sure.
He's angry that Guinness is calling him, among other things, Superman and the Patrick Ewing of suing. Here are some of the people he's...
Never won the championship?
Wow. That's a horrible reference.
He takes an extra step on the way to the courthouse?
Exactly. Patrick Ewing never quite got to promised land.
Patrick Ewing should be suing them for evoking his name this way. The Patrick Ewing of suing? J.R. Ewing of suing, I could go with.
It was all a dream.
Mm-hmm.
Well, here are some of the people he sued. New England Patriots coach Bill Belichick, former President George W. Bush, Somali Pirates, Britney Spears, Martha Stewart. He's also filed lawsuits against Plato, must be his estate, Nostradamus.
I think maybe Plato. Maybe Plato.
Plato. Plato.
Oh. Listen, I've been sued. You know, I'm 1/10 ownership in a restaurant, and they didn't pay for the like dry cleaning of the tablecloths or something, and the company that dry cleaned the tablecloths sued the restaurant. And I got served with a bunch of papers.
Nice.
Like, it's just completely out of hand. Well, either way, the guy's in jail, right?
He's in jail, and he's also sued Black History Month, the president of Iran, and butter substitute. I can't believe it's not butter.
He has a case.
Mm. Against who?
No, somebody. I mean, he's got a case somewhere.
Yeah, he's got a case somewhere.
You know, I can't believe it's not butter. There used to be something called chiffon, I think. If you think it's butter and it's not. And when I was a kid, I used to see commercials where they'd be at a supermarket and they do like the blind taste thing, which, by the way, I always enjoyed and wish they'd bring back. Any commercial where they were at a supermarket and they're like, we've taken Cola A and Cola B and we've had, and they would do butter versus like parquet right. or whatever it is. And more people chose parquet as butter over butter. And I'd always, even as a 9-year-old, I was like, look, it can win a taste test against other margarines, but it can't taste more like the thing it's trying to be than the thing is.
Watch.
Yeah, I mean, it is weird that more people pick the fake butter over butter. I could never believe that. Well, anyway, I would sue parquet.
Okay, can you believe this John and Kate plus 8 thing?
No. I mean, yeah, I mean, what the fuck? I mean, what's going on with that show?
Well, it had its premiere, which apparently got some huge number, doubling the season finale, which was just, you know, a month or so ago.
Was it even news before he got in trouble for cheating?
No, I mean, people liked the show. I think it did well on TLC. She maybe had a speaking tour and a book.
It's all over Entertainment Tonight.
It's everywhere. Like, it's the most searched story online.
What the fuck? They have 8 kids. He got gave a hooker a ride home in a Z car. Like what's the big deal?
Oh, he's allegedly cheating on her. People are I think they're fascinated because first of all, he's one of these always talking about God people.
Oh, he is.
He just got sued by Jenna Lee Riches.
Got sued by God. Quit dropping my name. That's right. If you're gonna go cheat.
Oh, so he's one of these God guys.
He's one of these God guys, and you know it's bizarre because I think you know look Kate. Gosselin obviously had some fertility treatment. She had twins, and then she had the sextuplets. And, you know, when they tell you you're going to have either 6 of these embryos took, many people would decide to selectively reduce some of those for the safety of the babies. She was probably of the mind that God gave me these children. But also God made her infertile to begin with. It's very confusing.
Yeah, where do you draw the science line? You know, like, I'm willing to forego God this much or not this much.
Oh, listen, it's completely self-serving with the religious idiots because, you know, stem cell research is playing God, but you getting a vein pulled out of your leg and replanted in your heart and a new valve, electronic valve from a pig or
totally
something,
putting
in your heart, that's all fine because that's you and has to do with you and your shit and your living and everything else has to do with someone else and Parkinson's and they don't give a fuck. So it's totally convenient. And by the way, just... You know, when it comes to medicine, I mean, the first time somebody got a blood transfusion, somebody said, you're taking the soul of the other person and putting it in you, right?
Oh, yeah. Or maybe they said ye. Early transplants really freak people out.
Oh, transplants, yeah. Forget about that, yeah.
I mean, the kids are cute, and God bless them. But Kate Gosselin, on her website... which I looked at because I was writing about them. She's posted all her husband's favorite Bible verses. And they sort of presented this kind of lifestyle. And I guess that's why it's interesting to people because, well, like all reality shows, you take somebody who is likely to have some sort of personality disorder.
Right.
And then you put them in a bubble and you judge them.
She seems like a coos and a half. But I got to say, just twins, like just when I'm trying to, look after the twins on a day the nanny's not around, and they're running five different directions, and they're not listening to anything you say, and they're defiant, and they're like, no, I'm going to, you know, and they just want to do whatever it is you don't want them to do, that's what they want to do, and if you say come this way, they want to go the other way, and blah, blah, blah. I couldn't imagine having eight of those kids running around simultaneously.
Yeah, and I mean, she, you know, I guess she does a good job. You never know how much help they have or what happens behind the scenes, but I find it interesting that TLC's programming is just fertility porn. Like, it's just people with massive amounts of kids, and it is completely fascinating.
Yep.
Like, you combine somebody who, and speaking of Dr. Drew, you know, in his book...
Dr. Screw,
he talks about, you know, giving that narcissism test to people, and the celebrities who scored the highest were reality stars.
Yes.
And it, because they were people who thought that they should be on TV, their lives should be televised, their lives were important. So you take somebody who's already wildly narcissistic, and then you put them in this kind of environment... And let the nuttiness.
Well, I mean, that's where it really. That's if you're Yo-Yo Ma and you can play the fiddle like none other, then you do deserve to be in front of an audience. As a matter of fact, you're sort of robbing society if you don't share your gift with society versus one of these reality stars who has nothing to offer and is somewhat delusional. So, in a way, being, you know, virtuoso, whatever. Whether it's an instrument, you know, I mean, if you're Whitney Houston and you're not singing, there's something wrong with you.
Right.
You should be singing. I mean, it's almost like a guy who's a very skilled craftsman who refuses to build cabinets or something. I mean, that's not narcissistic. That's just a gift that you have that you sort of share with the world. These are people that have nothing to offer, but yet insist on being in front of the camera.
You see that in sports kind of time when Michael Jordan retired and played baseball, and Barry Sanders sort of retiring on the cusp of breaking the record, like guys that could go on and do great things, but are like, you know what, I've had enough, I'm washing my hands of the affair.
Right.
It's a weird thing, you kind of wonder what the motivation is there.
Yeah, and, I mean, but these guys who have this gift, and I guess they could be narcissists, but just because you're good at something and you share it with the world doesn't make you a narcissist. Having nothing to offer and sharing it with the world does make you a narcissist.
Absolutely. And one thing that I thought was interesting about Dr. Drew's take is that I think if you don't really know much about it, and I don't, you just think narcissistic people love themselves. But he makes the opposite point, which is that narcissism comes from self-loathing. So we should really have compassion for Kate. Mm. And because she's not, it's not so much that she's loving herself, it's just that she's hating herself. And I can relate to that.
And he did celebrities of all, like from music and movies and reality shows and stuff too. Like he studied those people, right?
Yeah, he studied them and he categorized their scores, and the reality stars are way more narcissistic than, say, musicians or other.
But all that being said, from a guy who took the test and doesn't remember much about it, but evidently scored off the charts, it's a bogus piece of shit.
Nice.
Because
that's what people say when they fail.
Now,
it.
I thought your quote on the jacket cover, it's a bogus piece of shit, was inappropriate.
I took the test, and the test would say things like, when you enter a party, do you think everyone, all eyes are upon you, or do you think everyone in the room owes you? And I'd be like, I don't think either one. Right. And they'd be like, we got to choose one. Hmm. And I'd be like, so either, and I'm just making this up, but it was a bunch of those. So do I think everyone in the room is thinking about me, or everyone in the room owes me something? And he'd be like, yeah, you got to pick one. And so you just pick one. And I don't know how they end up with whatever they end up with, but I somehow scored... Actually, I don't remember what I scored. It's just I heard them making fun of me on Howard Stern. I think maybe
Oddly enough, I think the highest scoring person to whom he administered the test is Robin Quivers.
But she refers herself in the third person and says, like, we are not amused and stuff like that. I don't have any of that.
No.
I mean, I may have a personality disorder, but it's not narcissism. Not
Well, when you insist that, could you do it in the third person?
We do not have a narcissistic disorder.
That's you and your giant sack.
Well, Kate Gosselin's sister-in-law, Julie, is urging viewers not to watch John and Kate Plus 8. She was blogging over the weekend saying, since TLC is airing the old episodes, I thought I should shed some light on how the show works. We've discussed this before, but it's buried somewhere in the archived post. When the show first started, Kate made a wish list of things she wanted, and that became the theme of each episode. The carpet, twins room, bunk beds, cow, hair plugs, teeth whitening, trips, etc. Everything you see them do or buy is completely paid for out of the budget for the show or traded for free advertising. She goes on to say, don't believe everything you see. The children are also being prompted to say or do certain things. They sign their lives away to TLC and they will continue to spin the show to keep the viewer's interest. I don't believe this show will go away until the viewers decide that they don't want to be played anymore.
Well, as we said, it's one thing to do a reality show. It's another thing to start turning a reality show into a drama with creative editing. Donnie has worked on Big Brother and does a lot of editing. I brought this up before. It always drives me nuts where they go, before they go to break, somebody goes, look, I've got some news for you. And then they cut to the dad's face with a very stern look and a long pause. And then they go to commercial break. And then when they come back, they go, look, I've got some news for you. Your hair looks awesome. And the dad goes, thanks, son. And you go, wait a minute. What did you just create there? Oh, you just took a music sting. But you took a weird moment. Watch those shows.
A weird moment from about like 3 hours earlier
yeah,
or later.
Yeah, took a weird yeah, moment yeah. where they just showed the person's moment. Face. Right. Like, they do it on all those Desperate Housewives shows and stuff where they'll go, like, I want you to come with me this weekend to the Hamptons. And then they'll just show a picture of Teresa's face staring for Three Mississippi. And you go, what? She doesn't want to go to the Hamptons? Or she's angry about going to the Hamptons? And then they come back and they go, I want you to come to the Hamptons. Okay, when are we leaving? Well, you can't take shit from another episode or earlier that day and just isolate on it with a music sting. That's not reality TV. You're now cooking it. You're now making...
manufactured cliffhanger or drama or whatever. It's totally manufactured.
Completely. All right.
The real drama today.
I still like that Desperate Housewives. or that Real Housewives. The Real Housewives.
Oh, yeah, the Real Housewives.
That's a show.
I know. Even though you know it's Frankenstein and cooked, it's still kind of compelling.
Yeah.
Now, Donnie, as an editor, do you allow yourself A, cricket sounds, and B, the record scratch?
I personally do. I get yelled at about it sometimes, but I love the record scratch and the.
Oh, it's so fucked out, Donnie.
The cricket sounds I don't do. I love the record scratch.
You still do it?
So I've been doing the record out, Donnie. Come
I've been
on.
Doing the record scratch probably for about 15 years.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is the biggest story of the day, and if you are thinking about going into news, what you don't do is put the big story at the back.
Oh yeah, that's right.
But. Sonia Sotomayor, you may have heard of her, is President Obama's Supreme Court nominee.
Yes, she is.
Yeah, President Obama nominated
her. Big fan of hers for a long time.
You love
got
Sonia's
all her
work.
Trading cards.
She was great in a celebrity porn hat with Dr. Screw.
Yeah.
Sotomayor, she was nominated. She's a federal judge. She was nominated for the Supreme Court, positioning her to become the first Latino and only the third woman on the nation's highest court. She became a judge on the Federal Circuit Court back in 91. She was elevated to the Second Circuit Court of Appeals in Manhattan by Clinton in 1998. And Obama said at a news conference today that he was looking for somebody with a few qualifications. He wanted someone with a common touch, with empathy, and he also wanted rigorous intellect, a mastery of the law, an ability to hone in on key issues, and somebody who whose experience... can give a person a common touch and a sense of compassion.
Oh, and she's got to be Mexican because we'll be up past the 50% mark by the time the next election comes around, and that's going to look good on my resume.
Puerto Rican.
Whatever.
Puerto Rican.
Good enough.
She's 54, raised in the Bronx. Her parents moved to New York City from Puerto Rico during World War II. She was raised by her mother in a housing project. I believe nice. her father died when she was very young. And that her father's death came after she was diagnosed with diabetes.
Wow.
Yeah, she graduated from Princeton University and Yale University's law school. She was an editor of the Yale Law Journal. And she said, today I stand on the shoulders of countless people.
Scrappy.
Yeah.
Well, be prepared for change.
Change is coming?
No, it's just every time they talk about a Supreme Court appointee, there's always some change. Yep. Some one side or the other's worried about change, and it never seems to affect itself. Well, Roe v. Wade out the window. Yeah. Like it's always something is coming, but it never. There's always a lot of discussion on like talk radio. Like if she gets appointed, And then they vote on, and then another one of her gets appointed, then we're going to have a lot of... Next thing you know, jackbooted thugs are coming to your house to confiscate your forks and spoons, and they're not going to let you have guns, or Roe v. Wade is going to get... And it never... I don't know what they work on, but it never seems to... I'm done checking that score.
Well, some people are pissed off that she's a liberal judicial activist of the First Order.
Yeah.
And it's not... It looks like she's going to be confirmed, and the president wants to see her get confirmed before the Senate's August recess so that they can be ready for the start of the High Court's fall term in October. She will, of course, be replacing Justice Souter.
Oh, she will? Yeah. Where's Souter going?
He retired.
Yeah.
He's like going home.
Hey, I don't keep trying.
And I hope Ruthie holds on.
Ruth Bader Ginsburg?
Yeah, I hope
she still
holds
on the bench?
She, you know, she, I think, believe she had a little touch of pancreatic cancer.
A little dusting.
A little dusting, yeah. Mm. But I love her.
I wonder what Supreme Court justices get paid.
I think for some reason they get two and change.
That's what I was thinking.
But I don't know. But it really, all that stuff is all about what you get, you know, writing your books, your memoirs, or, you know, what people don't understand is the underground, not so much underground, but the circuit.
Right.
What they don't understand, whether it's Jon Stewart or Jay Leno, and I mean, Jay Leno told me he has not cashed one Tonight Show check in 18 years.
He just lives from his corporate job.
NBC
and stand-up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it is all, he should cash them all at once, like this Thursday, and bankrupt the company.
Yeah.
There'd be a run on NBC.
I mean, seriously.
Say all the quarter B of A. I like to deposit these checks.
And the checks are not, you know, 10 grand a week. The checks are probably more into the hundreds of thousands of dollars a week. Never used a penny of it. It's all road money. And like when Jon Stewart goes out and does these things, hits these colleges, does this corporate stuff, it's $200 to $250 a pop.
Yeah.
So the idea that you're drawing your salary from doing The Daily Show or doing the Tonight Show or doing or being on the Supreme Court or whatever, you're drawing a nice salary, but it's really just setting you up for these huge paydays. And I don't know if these people go out and hit the road every weekend and have Jim Norton open up for them, but I'm just saying, whether you're the president or whether you're a Supreme Court or whether you're Jon Stewart, the real money, especially for these guys, is when they hit the road.
College commencement address, for example. I'm sure you get a pretty penny for that.
Yeah, and it's insane what colleges have. And then it kind of pisses you off. Like, wait a minute. We're always talking about how high tuition is and how expensive it is and student loans and blah, blah, blah. You have 200 grand to give to Jon Stewart, plus you're going to pay for his NetJets to fly him out there and put him up at whatever. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't, you're first off, last time I checked, you didn't need weekend entertainment for the students. Like, it's not part of the curriculum. I mean, you could run a college without Jon Stewart coming by on a Saturday night and doing a 65-minute set, could you not? Listen, God bless him, but I'm just saying, how does that work as a college? And then where do colleges get all this money? And then if they do have all this money, you shouldn't be crying poor all the time.
Yeah, if you're a certain percentage of your tuition, let's say your tuition's $20,000 a year, a certain percentage of it goes to like student programming. It just comes out of the tuition, and they collect that from all the students, and then they have however much money, $1 million or whatever, to spend on bands or Jon Stewart or whoever to come by through the year.
Right, and maybe people would prefer it if their tuition was $19,500,
yeah, or maybe
and they didn't see Blues Traveler.
Right,
or,
exactly.
Or have, not that these aren't all fine entertainers, I'm just saying, how about you do this? How about you don't take it out of the tuition and you just say, look, Jon Stewart's coming to town. If you want to pay $25 right. for a ticket, go see him.
But if you're a student, I mean, if you're a school, it looks better in your brochure to say, first of all, there's a difference between saying we charge $19,500 and $20,000, for example. And by the way, every student gets to see Jon Stewart for free, or you know what I mean? Like last year we had Blues Traveler come around, everyone got a free concert.
Right.
Yeah. Right. I went to see Queen Latifah.
Hmm.
That was very enriching, but mainly because somebody gave me my first Percodan. Just a half of one.
You'll always remember.
In college, you saw Queen Latifah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I saw Queen Latifah, and I really just remember, I mean, just feeling sleepy and good, and maybe for the first time, like, things were okay with the world. Do we have time for one more story?
Yeah,
should
one
wrap
more
it up?
Story.
Okay, do you guys want to hear about why it was a bad day for the gays?
Yeah.
Or Mel Gibson's girlfriend?
Ooh. Bad day for the gays.
I want to hear what the story's all about.
Well, California's highest court upheld a voter-approved ban on same-sex marriages today. You might have heard about this story from CNN. But they did allow about 18,000 unions performed before the ban to remain valid. So if you were one of those 18,000 couples that got married when gay marriage was legal in California, the state will not make you get a divorce.
How did it go to the court who challenged it? I mean, were they trying to validate the vote?
It is so complicated.
It is complicated.
And then how does it work that you get grandfathered in on something that they didn't, that's Molly girl, by the way, that Molly. They didn't validate? I mean,
it's completely confused. So the California State Supreme Court is largely Republican, although they said it's unconstitutional for marriage to specifically be between a man and a woman. Then in November, there was a ballot initiative called Prop 8. And that passed.
Yeah, passed effectively banning gay marriage.
Right. Now, then this went to court again, and I think the reason it went to court, and this is complicated, but I think the people who were against Prop 8 were saying that this is a constitutional revision. It's not an amendment. It's too big to be called an amendment. Therefore, it can't be voted on by the people. Mm. It can't be a prop. It should really go through a different system.
Sounds like they're grasping at straws.
The real question here is, do I have to send George Takei out of Punch Bowl or not? Because yes. He's registered over at Crate and Barrel, and I feel like he's got me over one now.
Yes. Yes, you still owe him some salad tongs.
Because he got grandfathered.
Don't use salad tongs with the gays.
Sorry.
He got grandfathered. People. So now all the gays that didn't get married feel... It's weird because now they must feel like, fuck, we should have gotten married because it would have been,
couldn't
have taken us off the books.
I think that's why there was a rush to get marriage license. Remember that?
Right, yes, mm-hmm. I do.
So there was, 18,000 unions is quite a bit before that. So it was 6-1. Only one guy dissented. There was a lot of people chanting in front of the courthouse in San Francisco, shame on you. But I think this is going to, this is going to come up again.
Yeah. It'll be one of those things that'll happen eventually.
Yeah,
I'm
the one dissenter, Justice Carlos Moreno, wrote, "The majority's holding is not just a defeat for same-sex couples, but for any minority group that seeks the protection of the Equal Protection Clause of the California Constitution." California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger opposed the initiative, Prop 8. He praised the court for leaving the previous marriages intact and urged opponents of the decision to respond peacefully and lawfully. In other words, don't riot.
Yeah.
Well, the gays don't riot. I mean, if they do, it's like they take a little graffiti off a wall, then they straighten out a rug.
Very proactive rioting.
They plant. Yeah, the gays don't riot. That's one group that just doesn't riot, and if they did, I don't think you'd know it. Listen, I'm straight, I'm white, I don't care. I think that's a good place to wrap it up.
Yeah, there you go.
That's Teresa, your due date is when?
October 2nd.
October 2nd.
Yeah, that's the day that both Gandhi and Groucho Marx were born.
That's right.
Brian, you are halfway into your treatment.
Yep, week number 4 out of 6.
So we're keeping our fingers crossed for you. It's going well.
It's going according to plan.
According to plan. And we will, you will be in our thoughts and in some of our prayers, although I'm not a prayer. And you'll keep us updated and we'll come back.
Yeah.
And we'll do this as much as we can.
Absolutely. I'm trying to minimize the tumor talk, but I'll give you guys an update. And if you guys want to be updated, check out my website at hibrian.com. And my fiance, Christy, is writing a really detailed blog. I mean, if you really want to know what's going on, she pours her heart out, and it's amazing. It's at inconvenienttumor.com.
Yeah, right. It's great. I was telling Brian before that on my website, I can see what you've typed into Google to get to my website, and a lot of people, a lot of the search terms are an inconvenient tumor, bald Brian's tumor, funny-looking tumors, an inconvenient tumor, bald Brian, and then random stuff like Adam Carolla's mom and funny plus Vicodin.
Oh, you're funny plus Vicodin.
and your website, T, if people want to go,
exploitingmybaby.com, and I will say that I've been following Christie's And it really is amazing. And it's nice because I feel like I don't have to bug Brian and ask him a lot of questions about his treatment because I already know from reading An Inconvenient Tumor what's going on.
We try and keep it updated. I mean, because people, God bless them, people want to know. My family up north, you know, extended family, they all want to know what's going on. And it's hard to call everyone and be like, hey, here's how I'm feeling today. So it's a great way to put it out there.
All right. So An Inconvenient Tumor and Exploiting My Baby. Those are the two websites you can go to if you want to keep up with Bald Brian and Teresa Strasser. Until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Bald Brian, Teresa Strasser, my good buddy The Wheeze, and Mike Chaffee saying, mahalo.